Shirley, Shirley.
Thank you.
Sorry, my bad.
Any apologies for absence?
I don't think there are any.
Thank you.
We just got Councillor Kearney Cox and Councillor Leslie having a discussion.
Welcome, Leslie. Members' Code of Conduct, declarations of interest. Any members with any pecuniary or other interest, Anita?
Thanks, Chair. Just because I've been in some of the papers and mentions about housing associations, I'd just like to declare interest that I'm on the board of ESO Community Homes and also the Prima Board.
Thanks, Anita. Anybody else? Thank you. Could I just have confirmation, please, from all members that nobody is subject to a party whip tonight? Agreed? Thank you. Item three. I hope everybody's read the minutes of the last meeting and anything arisen from that. Any inaccuracies or anything else? And is it agreed? Anita?
Sorry, Chair, there's just obviously one matter arising really in relation to page one and the bottom paragraph where there was a discussion around whether or not we need to move the March 2019 meeting. I just wondered if there's been an answer to that at all, because it falls into pair.
Right. Thank you, Anita. Have we got any?
Yeah, we do have a meeting of all the chairs in the four committees, so this is one of the items we will discuss then. I think it impacts three four committees.
Is that okay, Anita?
Yeah, that's fine.
Thank you. So I'll sign the minutes as a true record. Agreed?
Agreed.
Brings us swiftly on to item four, which is a contentious issue to say the least. The management of the camper vans at coastal locations. Oh, Mark, I didn't see you there. Thank you, Mark.
First time I've used the new mic, Chair. I'm just trying to say, I was looking for the button.
Oh, yes, me too.
Press the button in the middle.
And when the red light comes on underneath, it's on.
Okay, good evening, everybody. Thank you. Thank you for inviting me along this evening. The purpose of this report is to just give an officer update on the issue of camper vans at coastal locations, and particularly at New Brighton. Just by way of background, during the past 12 months, numerous complaints have been received from residents in the New Brighton and the Wallasey wards regarding the issue of overnight parking of camper vans and similar vehicles along King's Parade and Coastal Drive in New Brighton. The concerns have focused on the aesthetics of these vehicles parking at this seaside location, and we've had some anecdotal evidence of some environmental offences being committed, such as waste and rubbish being dumped into the sea. Having said that, officers have visited the location on numerous times, and to date there has not been any tangible evidence of any environmental or other offences being committed that would warrant formal action being taken. The report in front of you also highlights that anecdotally we know that New Brighton is promoted amongst the campervan fraternity on a number of websites as a place to visit, and we know that obviously this will be in part due to the availability of free parking. It's also reported anecdotally that a proportion of these people who stay in these campervans do visit the local attractions in the New Brighton area, making use of the food and drink offer and contributing towards our tourism and our visitor economy. In October of last year, officers officers were contacted by ward members in the locality who requested a meeting to look at potential options for the management of camper vans visiting New Brighton. The options identified focused on either removing or discouraging camper vans from parking on the highway at that location through some form of regulation, or alternatively by incentivising such vehicles to park at an alternative off-highway site. And at that meeting, we talked through a number of options, the advantages and the disadvantages, and that's included as an appendix to this report. Under section 3.4 of the report, we highlight that, as members will be aware, as part of our budget process for the coming year, the council has recently been consulting on the proposal to introduce car parking charges at a number of coastal locations around the borough. That has included the Prom at New Brighton. And part of that traffic order proposal was the idea of charging any vehicle, including camper vans, a fee of around £20 per night for that overnight stay. Clearly, a proposal such as that, if it had gone through, would have obviously, we anticipate, dramatically reduced the number of camper vans parked at that location and obviously addressed some of the concerns that have been expressed by local residents. It is important to highlight, however, that in the last couple of days, as I'm sure you're all aware, the Leader of the Council has made a statement confirming that based on the feedback received as part of that consultation, the full suite of charging proposals at those coastal locations will not be taken forward by the Council. That's just a quick run through of the report, Chair, and I'm very happy to take any questions.
Thanks, Mark.
Thank you, Chair. Perhaps just if we could encompass any questions to Mark later on, because there is a member of the public here, Chair, who would like to address the committee. It might be a good idea to hear from Mrs. Foster and then perhaps.
Thank you for that, Leslie. It was remiss of me, actually. I should have mentioned that before Mark came on to speak. Thank you, Leslie. There is a Mrs. Foster here,
yes,
who wants to speak on behalf of the residents. So if you'd like to come forward, please. And it's the button in the centre, Mrs. Foster.
All right.
Good evening.
Can I just say, Mrs. Foster, you've got 5 minutes.
Right. Could I first of all ask who that gentleman was? I didn't hear any name or what department he was from.
Certainly. That's Mark Smith,
right,
who's the director in charge of technical services, okay, which covers highways. So Mark is as high as you can go before you hit God.
I tried to hit God first of all, Mr. Robinson, and didn't get anywhere.
So. I meant that metaphorically speaking.
You've all been given my notes and what bits of your information I'm trying to glean, and spent a lot of time because this is just going on and getting worse and worse. And it's been started off 5 years ago. We had meetings on residents of Montbegger Estates, and everybody agreed it was just, but it's gone to the point of being ridiculous. And this mentioning health and safety, how does the council see that 37 vans sometimes can get rid of their waste? It's just not with one toilet. And it's got to be emptied of all the caravans and the motorhead. Where's it going? And it's going into the ground or whatever. And it's obnoxious. And neighbours have said, I haven't actually experienced it, but they go walking down there and it just smells of urine. really don't, I can't say any more than what's down there, but the first letter was very fortuitous because this lady didn't know that this meeting was going to take place. But last weekend, with all the heat, it was quite at its peak when these people were just parking anywhere and everywhere, all over the hills, and that's not allowed really, but Wirral Council do not do anything about it. And also, on the back of King's Parade, there have been 18 motorhomes and caravans that have lived there for 2 years or more. And I pay £212 a month rates, and I should be considered, and so all the neighbourhood as well, that the rates we pay, we should be looked after. And it's not being addressed. And most of the councils round the coastline of England have got it sorted because they found exactly the same problems. Now, I've only enclosed a few of them, but I'm sure if I went online and looked further, I would find that there's no place in England where you can just dump your caravan for a week and pay nothing. I think I've probably said enough, I don't know, but it's all there for you. And I mean, I just feel just myself and my correspondence has been going on for a year, and really from Mr. Robinson I have got absolutely no satisfaction whatsoever, and neither have I from the staff that he employs, and he had to chase them to even answer me. Well, I paid rates for approximately 57 years, and this is the first time I have ever formally made a complaint. And I think it should be treated with respect and an answer of some sort, not just being fobbed off by these people bring revenue. They don't bring revenue. They park their vans, they don't move them because they lose their space. They might walk to New Brighton and get a cup of coffee or a beer, but they don't pay what we're paying as rates on what beggars draft. And I think we should be listened to. And especially now that this parking charges have been stopped. Thank goodness, I don't want that particularly, but I want them to be banned for overnight park. That's all. Because it shouldn't be allowed. Gypsies can't come, can they? And these people are no better than the gypsies. Or no different than the gypsies. You know, they shouldn't be there.
The gypsies are clear.
Would you mind?
Away.
Would you mind switching your microphone off, please? Thank you. And thank you for your eloquence and your brevity. Is any, before you get up, Mrs. Foster, are there any members who'd like to ask Mrs. Foster any questions?
Chair, not to ask Mrs. Foster any questions.
Yeah, but yes. Anyone would specifically like to ask Mrs. Foster any questions? Yeah, I will. Go on,
can I just ask, you said you have to have facilities and we have not got them. Where would you like the facilities to go?
That's Wirral's problem, not mine. They need to, actually, the lady that wrote the first letter, she would have been here tonight, but she's away in her camper van on a site that takes motorhomes, and she's paying for it. So, I'm sure Wirral could find space somewhere. I mean, it is a lovely place to come to, but we need the facilities. Also, I forgot to mention, can I just mention, that it could be a dangerous situation. Because these camper vans and caravan are so close together. If anybody, if there was a gas leak or something, or a child can't see out to, it could be, you know, potentially very dangerous.
Mrs. Boston, thanks very much. And before you go and sit down, I'd like to apologise on behalf of the council that you feel that our chief executive and his staff have been tardy and lack of response. So, as chair of this committee, I'd like to apologise.
Well, I'd like you to keep them up a bit.
We'll do our best.
No, honestly, I mean.
Well, Mrs. Foster, may I say, we are going to do our best as a committee to resolve it. And it is a very real and pressing problem.
Yeah, it is.
And as a committee, we're going to do our very best to try and resolve this.
Well, that would be absolutely lovely.
Thank you.
Thank you.
And I'd like to bring David Armstrong, who's for the people at the back there. David is the Deputy Chief Executive of the Council.
Thank you, Chair. And just to say thank you for that, Mrs. Foster. As you know, through Councillor Rennie, I did visit you at home. We had a really useful discussion about this, and you actually showed me firsthand what you were looking at from your home. It was from that Mark produced the paper that he went through. It was from that Mark produced the options sheet, which is attached to it. Clearly, we were then overtaken by events because of the proposed parking charges. And as Mark said, we anticipated that had that been implemented, the £20 charge would have deflected most, if not all, of these people elsewhere. What we have done in the meanwhile is continue to monitor it. Indeed, I've quite often come round that way to the town hall just to see what's there in the mornings. I have to say, it's probably 6 or 9 months since we met. I do feel the numbers have grown since then. I think the number of vehicles have grown, and I would agree with you from more careful observation, having met you, that at least in 2 or 3 of those caravans on the road back from the seafront, it does appear that people are living in those permanently. Again, I did ask about that within the council, and those vehicles are taxed and insured, and that makes it hard for us to take action. Again, another development which I only saw for the first time on Sunday is that for the first time, the areas where the caravans and caravanettes park at the 2 dead ends, one on the seafront and one on the back, were full. Vehicles were actually using the photographs for the first time. I saw quite a number of vehicles parking up on the big grass mound, just driving off the road and onto that area. So it does appear to be a developing issue. If the parking proposal was withdrawn, we would take advice from the committee, but clearly we could pursue whether other forms of traffic regulation orders could be applied, or any other requests the committee members have for us to take away and research any areas of possible solutions. Thank you.
Thanks, David. Mark, would you like to come back, please, so we can now take any questions that any of the members would like to ask? Chris?
Thanks, Chair. Mark, in your presentation and in the report, it talks about numerous complaints. Can you give me a number?
Thank you, Chair. So, in the last 12 months, we've done a quick check across a number of service areas. The traffic team through our Capsule and App CRM system. We've spoken to Environment, Health and Training Standards colleagues. We've checked with the Safer World Hub and the people that deal with any issues around antisocial behaviour. Also, the lady who leads our housing and accommodation side as well. So during the last 12 months, we've had there's between 25 and 30. So there's about 20 complaints that have come in on the traffic side that relate to the impact of camper vans and the fact that when they're there, they reduce the amount of available on-street car parking. Some of those complaints touched on complaints about littering as well. We've had the Environment Health one complaint there that was an allegation about somebody selling tyres, but again, our training standards people have been out there, had a look at that, no evidence of any issues that way, and all the vehicles were registered, etc. No complaints through the Safer World Hub on the antisocial behaviour side, and then on the housing side, certainly on behalf of local residents, a number of our local councillors have raised concerns about this issue, and those have gone in there. So in total, it's between 25 and 30.
That's good.
Dave, I think your hand was up first.
Mike, I haven't finished.
I'm sorry.
I haven't finished. That's just my first question. Okay, given what you said, and not belittling the situation at all, because I agree with Mr. Potter. But there was a Freedom of Information response put in by Mr. Slater. And that FOI request, response to the council, shows there were 5 complaints during 12 months. So I think we owe Mr. Slater an apology for misleading him. Because clearly the council haven't got back together. If you're saying there's 20 to 25, and you've never worried because they're saying there's 5, then something's going completely wrong. So I think that's something that Mr. Slater might need an apology. And perhaps another response from our Facebook information officer. As I say, I'm not belittling the situation. I'm a former caravan owner. And I agree with Mrs. Foster, I would never consider travelling with my caravan, with my caravan toilet, with contents in it, or with a flush with contents in it. So if I was parked somewhere where there wasn't a facility to dispose of that waste, I'd have to find somewhere. And I know there's a public toilet on the corner opposite, but we shouldn't be disposing of caravan waste in there. There are proper chemical disposal points for this sort of waste, not simply public toilets. So that isn't an answer. And being the sort of simple person I am, I find it hard to understand how it's reached the situation. Why not just impose an 11 p.m. to 7 a.m. ban on overnight parking? There's a sign on Lisa Common, no overnight parking. Okay, we've also put barriers up there and realise we can't put barriers everywhere. But why not just implement an overnight ban? It is simple, simple solution. No overnight parking.
Would you like to respond to that, Mark, please?
Yes, please, Chair. Obviously, in terms of regulating the highway and putting a ban like that in place, so that is one of the options that we raised and talked about last October. I think, as David has said before, obviously some of this is superseded by events that moved along around the charging proposal. But that's certainly something that, as officers, we could do further work around that. We do know in practical terms that if we were going to do something like that, it does pose some challenges. So we know that in terms of putting a vehicle ban on the new Brighton Prong, based on the length of that section of road, we'd actually need to spend quite a significant amount of money as a council and actually erect a very large number of signs along the front. So there would be a capital cost of introducing that. So that's the first challenge. The second challenge is if we are looking to just prohibit camper vans and not all vehicles in general, then that does pose some difficulties around how we do that. So one of the complications is that there's a DFT, a Department for Transport definition around what is a camper van and motorhome. And as we're all aware, vehicles of different classes have a different status. They used to have a tax status that was visible on a tax disc, but obviously we don't have tax this now. So there's the very practical side of, if we have enforcement officers patrolling that location, how do they distinguish what is a camper van or a motorhome and what isn't? And we need to bear in mind that certain members will be aware of a very popular recent trend where we get people with those Volkswagen style vans, and very often we'll fit those out and put the kitchen and various things inside. So there are some challenges there, and at this moment in time, the parking services team, Steve Atkins and the team, have been looking at some examples around the country of places that have been doing that. So one example of that would be a very recent example over in North Mid Wales, at the council in the Aberystwyth area, has looked to introduce a motorhome camper van ban along their front on a trial basis to see how that goes. But again, in practical terms, the enforcement officers are using some basic criteria around, does the back of the van have glass and have windows to prove that it will be something that someone could reasonably sleep in? And then those enforcement officers are looking in to see whether there's evidence of people sleeping or whether there's a sink or toileting facilities, etc. So we're trying to get feedback from some of the case studies and look at how other places are doing this. But it would require further work. It's not a straightforward solution, and there would be a capital cost of doing something doing something like that.
Dave, and then
thank you very much, Chair. I'm going to highlight the two emails that I think everyone will receive. One which Councillor mentioned before from Peter Slater. Given it a completely different figure, but when you look at the documentation that was presented by Mrs. Foster, it's a completely different view. The other one which is more interesting is one from Tom Hell, who's the caravan, obviously, enthusiast. And you read the information that he's given there, you can see that lots of other authorities are struggling with the same problem. And at the moment, what's it, Fleetwood, Lancashire, and the coast, and Blackpool are all doing trial periods at the moment. To try and come to an answer. Listening to the comments that Mark's just made in relation to how difficult it is to categorise individual vehicles to make sure that we get it right, I would propose that we actually set up a working party and look into the whole issue in relation to this, so that in the event of us implementing any action, we get it absolutely correct and we're not held to ransom.
Thanks for that, James. Thank you. Leslie.
Chair, can I just ask just two questions really, and then perhaps if you let me come back later on when the members have spoken. First of all, just on what Councillor Mitchell has alluded to about the numbers, absolutely spurious that on one email it says 5 and another obviously says it was 25. As it mentions in the report here, it says that we've had numerous in the last 12 months. I mean, myself and my board colleagues, we've been working on this now for nearly 5 years. And when it first started, and there was just a handful, we took along the then strategic director, Mr. Walter, who's now gone from the authority. And he was tasked at the time by the then chief executive to do something about this. There was numerous complaints went in at that time. So where are all the complaints lodged that we made, residents made, over the last 4 to 5 years? Because they clearly need to be accounted into this. I mean, I've got most of my correspondence still on email, so if I've got it, then clearly the authority should have it. And I'd also just like to ask you if you could give me some reason why we are making this so complicated in saying we've got to define what a camper van is. You know, has it got windows at the front, has it got the back, is somebody sleeping? Why can we not have a total ban of vehicles parking overnight on that stretch of land, on a stretch of land that leads down to the sailing club as well? Why can't it just be a total vehicle ban? We could even say it wasn't 11 o'clock because clearly people might park there, walk down to the facilities in New Brighton. So we said 12 midnight to 7 a.m. in the morning with a total ban of vehicles. That takes the whole of the complications out of that. So I'd like an answer first of all on those. And just to try to use, and I hope we're not going to use the fact that the council has now, very pleased as I am, a complete U-turn and decided not to impose parking charges on our coastal areas. If that had have gone ahead and we had have charged £20, I don't believe, and the residents don't believe, that that would have solved the problem, because these people clearly want it for free. And all that would have happened is that those vehicles that are parking there now would have been displaced onto the residential roads, such as where Mrs. Foster lives, and we'd have had a whole new issue on our hands. So just for now, Joe, if those questions and
thank you, Chair. Just to go back to the issue of the number of complaints and inquiries that have come in. So I'll check back on the FOI from the gentleman, Mr. Slater. Clearly, that number there that's on the FRI, I mean, we've had a number of complaints that have gone in for our particular team. I've done a check to see whether there have been any broader issues reported around camper vans. So one of the things I'll check, it doesn't necessarily mean that the numbers that were provided are incorrect, but there's something about the scope of the question and the FOI that I'd like to check. Today, and you know, for this meeting, I've gone across all of the teams and asked for inquiries or issues that are broadly related to camper vans. So we've had a look on the traffic side about things around parking, displaced parking. We've pulled all of those into that category because it's given us the biggest number and the clearer picture of an issue. And I would just highlight that this has been a quick check back over the last 12 months. And certainly, you know, I would confirm from discussion with council and any and others that we know that before that, this wasn't just a problem that started 12 months ago. And I absolutely do not dispute that we had a record of issues being raised before then. And I'm sure that the number, if we did go back and check through the council, is probably much higher. But I'll check back on the accuracy of the FOI. In terms of the practicalities of enforcing such a restriction, I've outlined some of the difficulties if we wanted to make it so it just applied to camper vans and motorhomes, but clearly those enforcement issues and difficulties, if we made the ban for all vehicles on the prom, as Councillor Rennie has outlined as a possibility, then clearly that dispenses with all of that. So we're just down to the practical side of very much, you know, that cost of implementing such a proposal, whether it's doing a regulatory proposal such as that, or whether it's about finding alternative sites. I think one of the challenges that the council faces is that to do something like that, it is about finding the money and the investment for such a proposal. Just broadening the debate out slightly, before the meeting tonight, I was talking to my colleague who's the lead commissioner for tourism and visitor economy. Members will be aware that we have a visitor economy strategy in place. One of the things that's a real success for Will is that we know that we're the fastest growing tourism visitor economy district in the city region. Since 2010, we've seen an increase from the strategy about 8 million visitors per year, about 26% increase in the numbers of people that are coming to Wirral and enjoying our coastline and our visitor and our tourism economy. So there's some very useful broader context here that's very much within the remit of this committee, and obviously the camper van issue is part of that, and it might be that potential solutions to this and finding, you know, money to do things like this, the trick might be that they sit within that broader strategic debate, maybe. Thank you.
Thanks, Mark. I think David would like to come in and just add something to that. Thank you, Mark.
Thank you, Chair. Just a couple of points. Firstly, clearly we should get the figures right with the FOIs. I'm sorry if we've given out two different figures. I suspect what's happened is when the FOIs come in, the FOI officers probably maybe only asked across the parts of the council that they thought would apply. Mark has done a more thorough search. We'll take this back as an example. There's a lesson to be learned from that. Mark's right about the technical stuff, because I thought I'd seen the answer. I went to the East Coast, I think he was filing, I took a photograph of a sign that said motorhomes prohibited, and then when I read the legislation, I discovered that we could spend £20,000 putting those signs all down the prop and all down the road on the other side of the dips, and actually there are a whole series of vehicles that can come still legitimately park there. So I think we'll take your guidance on whether you want us to work on these things some more. Similarly, overnight ban, you're right, it's a straightforward solution. The issue there to be discussed and for us to be advised, obviously, if you want us to pursue that, is how far you take it, because there's probably a temptation if we put it into the two stub road ends where they're currently parking and nowhere else, they'll simply find the quiet roads to parking down there, and there are a whole series of quiet roads down there away from the prom that's still next to the prom. So again, clearly with the parking proposals drawn, subject to your guidance, we're happy to look at all these options, but for each of them carries some things to talk through, really.
Thanks, Dave. Just for clarity, members, I've got Anita, then Steve, then David, and Pat, and then if anyone after that you just raise your hand and I'll let you down. So, Anita.
Thanks, Chair. I just really wanted to comment on the night time one first of all. As an avid user of New Brighton, I quite often drive up to New Brighton, leave my car there overnight whilst I go to the cinema for a meal, for a drink, etc., as do a lot of my neighbours and a lot of my friends. So I think we could be affecting the economy if we actually do that. Also, if we restrict it to certain areas, I just think, as David's just said, that it will just displace the caravans, because what we've read in the representation from the caravan motorhome owners is that they want to come to Brighton. So I'm supportive of Councillor Mitchell's statement about having a working party, but I think that working party should include the caravan owners as well as the residents and councillors and officers. I don't think we can restrict it to just being an internal matter, because obviously we're not living and breathing it like the residents are, and also we're not caravan owners who, and, you know, they'll have their own hotels. And Mr. Tom Pell has said he's worked with a number of councils and found a way forward. So I think we owe it to everybody to be fair to do that investigation. But I think, you know, in terms of the nighttime ban, I certainly wouldn't be supportive of that. A number of my friends wouldn't be. But I do understand the sentiment of that, to try and alleviate the problem. And it is a problem. And I think the working party would be the solution to that.
Anthony. Steve.
Thanks, Chair. Just a couple of points. Mainly on what Mrs. Foster was commenting on before. Licensed touring sites, there's the strict rules regarding spacing. She mentioned space on one of the pictures shows. There's very strict rules on all licensed sites in this country and abroad, mainly because nearly every one of these vehicles carries either car gas or propane. Also, the sites. It's very strict on, they have firefighting equipment and alarms in place with signage throughout the site, and also the chemical disposal points, which we were talking about before. The thing about the old vehicles, I know what Mark's saying, legally some of them are converted vehicles, but I would still say, looking at the pictures of what I've seen down there, 95% of those vehicles, any person would look and say that's a caravan.
Thanks, Steve. David.
Yes, thank you, Chair. I wanted to approach this from a slightly different direction. We had the public meeting at Melrose Hall that Mark and Steve Atkins attended, and clearly the definition of what was and what wasn't a camper van was going to be a problem, and I fully accepted that. I would observe that, in fact, in the Lake District and in parts of Yorkshire where I used to live and operate, they don't try to define the camper van. What they say is no overnight sleeping. And there are signs prominently up at the entrance to where the areas where those vehicles are being parked, which makes it quite clear that it's an offence to sleep overnight. And that doesn't prevent anybody parking a vehicle there that might well be used, as Anita has said, for somebody going out for the night. But what it does stop, and it quite clearly stops and prevents, is anybody overnight sleeping. Now that can be policed. It's been policed elsewhere, and I would suggest it could be policed here. Whether it had the unintended consequences of knocking people off into car parking areas in adjacent roads, well, we're back rehearsing the argument of why parking was so impractical, parking charges in Boy Lake and West Kirby, etc., was such an impractical solution. But I believe somebody wants to look seriously at the way this has been dealt with in parts of Yorkshire, to my knowledge, and certainly in the Lake District, where they say no overnight sleeping. That would stop this in its tracks. Thank you, Chair.
Thank you, David. Would you like to comment on that excellent suggestion or take it away?
I think, Chair, we take that away. You know, it's an interesting idea. I suspect the authority concerned will have used another piece of legislation or a bylaw or something to actually enforce that activity. Well, that's a great need for us, Councillor Elton. We'll take that away. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you, Mark.
Thank you. Just a couple of things, if I may. We met with Councillor Rennie, Councillor Lewis, policy board councillors, and ourselves, myself and Councillor Jones, the New Brighton councillors, along with Mark, as was alluded to earlier in this report. We discussed numerous issues that we've in this report we're going to talk about tonight, to find ways of helping the situation. And we disagreed in a number of ways, but I think one thing we did agree on, that if we were going to restrict these motorhomes from parking there, and we had our opinions, different opinions on that, that it needs to be equipped there, right? So, yeah, the attraction of New Brighton, as they say in the report, they're coming there because of the attraction of New Brighton, as Anita has just mentioned, and she goes there regularly with her friends. So the attraction of New Brighton and the coming, let's find somewhere for them. Mark has mentioned it, of course, that's one of the options. Let's find somewhere that can provide all those electricity points, the chemical disposal points, etc., water and that. And don't forget down there actually at the moment, because of the wooden shed, you have got a lot of place already. But you know, we tried various things. We looked at, and Mark said it wasn't possible, physical barrier. Remember, that wasn't possible. You know, regardless of my views on the parking charges, I still can't understand why you're against the parking, the £20 parking charges overnight, and get petitions up against them, and that would have solved it for you overnight, without a doubt. They wouldn't have parked it. I mean, they've even said in this report, the motorhome people, that the most they pay is £10, if you charge £20, there's just no way we're going to park it. Yet you got a petition up against that. I'm just baffled by that, to be quite honest with you. But anyway, we are where we are now. But just a couple of other points that I make. Mark's mentioned about the number of letters, and you can argue one way or another. We've certainly had no letters of objection in New Brighton. You have, as you said, in Wallace. Well, yeah, absolutely. But we haven't. And, you know, a lot of those, again, as Mark Smith has just mentioned, you know, there's no evidence to suggest it's even motorhome people. And don't forget, we just had, and you were down there, a picture of you in the paper, we just had the travellers there in force. So what to say, it wasn't the travellers that dumping a lot of the rubbish. And again, going back with the success of New Brighton, and certainly with the lovely weather, it's been absolutely grand the weekends. And of course, one of the main issues, besides parking, of that success has been litter. You know, but I think we've done well in terms of that. And we have New Brighton's litter picking group helping the council out, which is very helpful. But you know, in terms of the environment as well, you could argue, well, they stand out as ugly against that environment, against that backdrop, because they're surrounded by concrete blocks in that area. So, what's more ugly than concrete blocks or caravans? So, I do think we need to look at it. There's lots of issues here. And the other one, before I forget, is, and again, okay, it's debatable, but we need to look at it in more detail. Well, they say they're coming to New Brighton. Certainly, we have heard that they're spending an awful lot of money in New Brighton. And we're talking about the visitor economy. That's one of the issues, isn't it? One of the pledges in the rural plan, one thing we're talking about, and also through the New Brighton Coastal Community Team.